Hello, I'm Kent Weakley, and today I'm going to show you how to make this photo. Okay, I'm probably not going to show you how to make exactly this photo. What I really want to show you is how to make a photo of a large group. This happens to be the Ocala Honor Flight, and I was invited to ride along to photo document the event. Actually, I went three years in a row photo documenting various honor flights. This is where World War II veterans are brought to Washington so they can see the World War II memorial that was made for them. The history of how this started is pretty impressive. There is a doctor in Ohio who had a patient that was a World War II veteran, and at the time the memorial had just recently been completed. He asked his patient if he was going to go visit it, the memorial, and he basically said there are two reasons why he couldn't afford it, and he didn't travel very well. Well, the doctor was also a pilot, so he invited his patient to ride along with him and go visit the memorial in Washington. That was the very beginning of the very first honor flight. From there, other private pilots got together, and they would caravan, basically a parade through the sky of World War II veterans to go to Washington on weekends. And then from there, that blossomed into municipalities deciding to raise funds and do an even bigger honor flight. Our community in Central Florida had one of the largest participations in the honor flight. We would take literally hundreds of people up every single year to go visit the memorial. And I got to be part of three of those years. It's very exciting. Okay, so let me share with you a little bit what this is like to go on an honor flight. We start out incredibly early. It's like 3-4 o'clock in the morning. Families are bringing all the veterans to the local airport. From there, we board onto a private charter plane. I created a few time lapses using a GoPro, and it's kind of neat to see all of the people involved. There are almost as many volunteers as there are veterans that go on these. Now, here's an interesting thing that occurred. On this particular mission, the flight was delayed a little bit. Their arrival to our local airport delayed this flight. So we didn't take off as early in the morning as we were supposed to, which was fantastic because we were able to get blue hour, which that's a whole other story. Shot this on my camera backpack. I had no tripod with me. Everything is handheld. So I basically have the camera sitting on the backpack doing a long exposure, absorbing all that blue hour sky. This is my buddy that I rode with on the flight. It's an incredible reception that they have for all the veterans when we arrive at the airport. This was very interesting. On one of the missions, Bruce Mozart is basically the inventor of the underwater camera. Is part of our community, and he also was a World War II veteran. He was making images inside the rotunda at the Senate building, and I was able to capture him doing that. He has since passed away, but I was a little bit nervous making images of him. He's a very well-known photographer. Okay, so everything was fine and very straightforward to this point. We were about halfway through the day, and the directors of the program wanted to do the group shot in front of the Lincoln Memorial on this particular trip. This is where all the pressure turns on me. Prior to this, everything was candid, and we're just walking around, having some great time, capturing your images wherever we can. There's really not much pressure. At this point, all the pressure's on you to make a great image. So what to do? First of all, we have a very large group. There's over 200 people on this flight. So we knew we were going to set them up in front of the Lincoln Memorial. most of them, or not most, but a majority of them are in wheelchairs. So we can't go up the steps. So it has to pretty much be in front of these steps. So I coordinated with as many volunteers as I could as quickly as possible and explained how we would set this up. Originally, we were thinking the wheelchairs would be off on the ends of the group, but there were enough wheelchairs basically made the entire front row. Once I communicated with enough of the volunteers where I wanted them to stand and what the left and right side limits were for our group, they did a great job of coordinating and getting everyone in place. While they were doing that, I was shooting multiple images to check my exposure. What I didn't want is I didn't want to have blown out images or too dark images. I was rather fortunate because it was an overcast, gray, drizzly day. That helped diffuse the light. Had there been direct sunlight and hard shadows, this would be a really tough shot. This image was shot at f11, and I wanted that f11 aperture so that I had a decent depth of field, so people in the front row and the back row would still appear sharp. In order to get that depth of field, I needed to shoot a little bit faster, so I dialed up my ISO to ISO 400. That allowed me to shoot at 1/160th of a second. Now, the lens I was using is my wide telephoto, which is 28 to 70 millimeter, and I'm using about a 48 millimeter point in that telephoto range, so about a 50 millimeter distance, focal distance. So I shot a few images, made sure I wasn't blown out and I wasn't getting deep shadows, and I confirmed that by looking at the histogram. At that point, I made sure that that setting was a full manual setting. In other words, I'm not shooting in shutter or aperture priority or program. This is manual because I don't want these images to fluctuate while I'm creating them. I don't want one to be darker or lighter than the others. The other thing that I needed to do is I needed to set my focus. In this case, I set my focus on one of the center rows that allows the depth of field to move in front of and behind that focus plane. And then I moved the lens to from autofocus to manual focus so that it wouldn't try to refocus as I made the multiple images. And then I simply started from the left, holding the camera vertically, and moved left to right, capturing these images. The trick was to get everybody to pay attention. That was the real challenge. So from my vantage point, I also had a particular tile or stone in the pavement there that I could see a particular mark in it. I knew that's where I was standing because I didn't want to reposition myself. But I moved forward to the group and made it clear, I'm going to make a lot of images here, guys. So just keep looking at me and smile, please. Okay. Even if you don't see the camera pointed at you, just stay right where you are. Doing a handheld panorama with a group is a challenge because we're conditioned people seem to be conditioned that if the camera's not pointing to them, they don't think they're being photographed. So they just relax and they'll start doing things. So I made multiple passes of this because the first time I did it, I noticed that were people that were breaking into conversation and relaxing and not looking at the camera. So I repeated myself. I said, guys, you all have to look here. Okay. Just look at me, please, while I'm making these. Don't look away. I made another series and I made another series just to cover myself. Now, what was really critical, I had no time to look at my LCD, no time to chimp. That would be the worst case scenario. If I stopped and looked down at my camera and started going through these images and trying to decide if they're sharp and all that, they would definitely start moving around and disband. So I had to stay focused on this. I had to know that each one of my shots was going to be as sharp as possible. And the way to cover myself was to shoot it multiple times. So once I did make that final last pass, I quickly on the back of the camera, the LCD, I zoomed in and confirmed that the faces were sharp on each of the images. So I'd go through each image, left to right, and make sure they weren't soft or blurred. And inevitably I had people that were had their heads down or weren't looking or whatever the case might be, but there was nothing I could do about that. You can't make everybody fit together each time. So that's how I did it. And that was the first go around. I'm going to show you another one here, some other images. This is pretty cool because there was a school group at the Tomb of the Unknown. And our guys got off the bus and got to do a handshake line with these kids from Ohio. These two gentlemen presented the wreath at the Tomb of the Unknown. And here they're being greeted and informed by one of the tomb guards. Okay, so let me show you another group shot. I'm going to show you how this worked. This is a time lapse of the group shot. Now, this was the second time that I got to go there. We knew we wouldn't have the advantage of elevation, so to speak. I coordinated ahead of time to see if we could get a ladder. This is about an 8-foot step ladder. So I clamped my GoPro on this, and I climbed the ladder to shoot this group photo. I want to show you what this looked like before, during, and after the group photo. There's a group shot right there, and they're done. And they're off doing their stuff. You can see we really only have a few moments to get everybody together and make the shot and then move on. This shot was shot the same way. I typically will get my exposure setting somewhere in the middle of the scene and make sure my exposure is set properly. I'm shooting vertically again, holding the camera vertically. And the reason I do this is I'm maximizing pixels. Because we're going to add these images together, the width is going to be as large as I want it. The height is limited by whatever the camera can do. Well, the camera can make more pixels vertically, so I shot this vertically. The other thing I failed to mention earlier that you need to know is when you shoot a panorama, you make sure that you overlap these images by at least a third. So if you see here, if you look at this guy on the right with the red shirt that's sitting there with his hands around his knees, he's in three of four of these images. So I'm really overlapping these to make sure that we get everything we could possibly get with these. And there's the final image put together. Yeah, the experience of getting to see these guys and hear some of their stories and then get to see how the other people there react to them, it was definitely one of those experiences you'll never forget. One other trip. This is cute. There are greeters at the airport. There are people all over Washington that volunteer to make these honor flights extra special for all the veterans so that they have something to really remember their trip from. This is returning to the airport in Ocala. This is a water salute by two fire trucks as the plane's taxiing onto the tarmac. This is the third trip that I made with the Honor Flight. The previous photo that you saw, if you realize what we did, I'll show you. Right here. We basically blocked the entire World War II monument from anyone passing through this particular location. It was only for a few moments, and the ramp is still accessible behind it. However, we were told that we weren't supposed to do that. So we didn't, and we cooperated. Instead, we lined everybody up with space behind them so people could get through. If you look here, too, I put this in here so you can see. At this point, I'm shooting to get my exposure. I really want to get that exposure down, make sure I have the camera locked into its setting and ready to go. So as soon as these guys figure out what line they're in, and they're ready, I'm ready, because I only have a couple seconds. again, left to right. You see I've got a real tight overlap here. There's the final image. Now, you might be asking, why not take this shot with a wide angle lens and simply crop out the top and bottom and make a long skinny image? You could do that. However, you would not have the resolution that will make this a great image. I'm able to print this incredibly large and it looks fabulous. Let me look at the image file size. This is a cropped version of it, but it's over 6,000 pixels wide. And you can see all of the detail of everybody's face through here. And it's just, it captured the moment quite well. So building the panorama is definitely beneficial in a situation like this. The biggest trick I would say is getting everyone to pay attention and commanding their attention towards your camera. That is critical. And making sure they understand that when the camera's not pointing at them doesn't necessarily mean you're done. Okay, so let's go into Lightroom and Photoshop, and I'm going to show you how I assembled this image. I'm going to do the image with the Lincoln Memorial in the background. Essentially, what I do is I grab that series of images from left to right, and in Lightroom, we go Photo, Edit In, Merge to Panorama in Photoshop. Now, the newer versions of Lightroom will do this inside Lightroom. This particular version I have allows me to do this inside Photoshop. The images get sent over to Photoshop. I select all of the images, and I usually just leave this on auto. It does a pretty good job. If I need to, I will make a correction here. And you can actually see Photoshop doing its thing. It's taking each image and creating a layer, stacking those, and then finding common digital elements on each side of those photos to interlock with one another to create the panorama. Okay, so Photoshop has assembled all of the individual frames and put them together in multiple layers. You can see those layers right here. So the first thing I'm going to do is flatten those layers. Okay, I'm going to hit C for crop, and I'm going to crop this image. And when I crop it, I'm also going to do a slight rotation to the left. I'm looking at that horizontal line down here. The building in the background isn't as centered as I would like it to be. And on the final image that I put together, I spent more time adjusting that as well. Essentially, that's how the image was made. Some more enhancements to that would be to add some saturation. I'm actually going to add some vibrance and saturation. And one of the other elements that I added to this was the text in the foreground, which appeared to be on the pavement. I'll show you how that's done real quick. I'm changing my foreground color to white. And I'm basically going to stretch out using the text tool. I'm going to use a stretch out a box here. And I'm going to write in this. I'm just going to call this Honor Flight. I like to go up to the text size tool. And if you look next to the letter T beside this size, you scroll over that T, you can click, hold, and drag out a larger size. All right, that should be good. Now, that doesn't look like it's matching the pavement or the pavers very well, does it? Once I have the text in a nice large size like that, I'm going to select the text layer. And I'm going to rasterize that text. This is making it into pixels versus a text object. Then I'm going to hit Command T for transform. If I right-click on the corner, I have a list of options, and distort is one of those options. Now, I can actually use these pavers to figure out my perspective for this. And basically, I'm looking at the left side of the letter H in honor, and the right side of the T over here. I'm going to drop those in place. Now, I'm going to go up to Layer, Layer Style. I'm going to do an inner shadow. I'm going to change the size of that shadow a little bit so it looks like it has some depth to it. And I'm going to go up to the layer that has the Honor Flight text on it, and I'm going to take the opacity down to, let's say, about 50%. And that gives you an idea how the text Honor Flight was laid onto the pavement in those images as well. Let's go back and look at the final result over here. So there you have it. If you have a large group of people and you're looking to make a really nice portrait of them, using a panorama technique, holding the camera vertically, setting up a manual exposure with a manual focus, and hand-holding each shot as you go from left to right, making sure you have about a third of an overlap on each image, will do the trick for you. The biggest challenge is getting everybody to cooperate with you. So if this is helpful to you, please let me know. If you do large portraits such as this and you have other techniques, please leave a comment. I'd love to hear how you make your large group shots as well. And until then, as always, happy shooting.